Hello everyone, welcome back to botany class. In previous video, we discussing the molecular basis of inheritance. And in that, we started with the structure of nucleotide. And then we discussed about the primary structure of DNA. And secondary structure of DNA proposed by James Watson and Francis Crick. And then we started discussing about search for genetic material. In that we discussed two important videos, transforming principle conducted by Frederick Gripth and biochemical characterization conducted by Oswald Avery, Colin McCord and McLean McCarty. And then we discussed the search for genetic material, the property of genetic material, DNA versus RNA. And then we discussed another one important experiment, that is experimental evidence for the DNA replication is semi-conservative one, right? And in this video, we are going to see, we are going to revise whatever we discussed in previous videos. Same, just we are going to see one revision here. Some important topics along revision in this video, right? And when structure of the nucleotide. So because DNA, RNA molecule, both they're made up of four different type of nucleotide. The type of nucleotide found in DNA molecule is deoxyribonucleotide and in RNA is ribonucleotide. The difference between deoxyribonucleotide and ribonucleotides are only the pentose sugar. So the DNA nucleotide contain the deoxyribose sugar, but whereas RNA nucleotide contain ribose. So sugar, that is the main difference. And the nucleotide which are present in DNA and as well as RNA molecule, so each nucleotide has three important component, right? One nitrogen base and one pentose sugar, one phosphate group, right? So nitrogen bases, there are two types are there, already we discussed, purine and pyrimidine. And purine, this is a heterocyclic compound. They are having and the structure which consists of two ring structures are present. One 6-member ring, another one is 5-member ring. Pyrimidine bases, they are also heterocyclic compound with only single membrane ring structure. But you see here, I given the diagram of purine, the structure of purine and pyrimidine bases, right? So purine bases, na, they are having two rings. Okay, you see here, this is a 6-member ring and this one is a 5-member ring. So there are two types of purine bases are there, adenine and guanine. And I told purine bases, they have or they contain four nitrogen atom in it rings, right? Four nitrogen atom in it rings. But pyrimidines, they contain only two nitrogen atom. Purine bases, the nitrogen atoms are present in, okay, see here at position number one. So position number one nitrogen atom is there. And position number three, one nitrogen atom. And position number seven, one nitrogen atom. And position number nine, one nitrogen atom, right? So totally four nitrogen. So here also similarly, 1, 3, 7, and 9. This is the structure of adenine and structure of guanine. You see the difference between adenine and guanine is, okay, the difference is here you can see the sixth carbon contain amino group here, but whereas guanine is sixth carbon contain oxygen atom, so whereas second carbon contain amino, that is the main difference between adenine and guanine, right? The structural difference between the purine bases, the adenine and guanines are, so adenine, they can have one amino group at position number sixth. But here position number 6 instead of amino group contain oxygen, but second carbon contain amino group. That is a major difference, structural difference between adenine and guanine. So these two bases comes under purine bases, right? And pyrimidine bases, you can see here, there are three pyrimidine bases are there. So first one is thymine, uracil, and thymine and cytosine. So these three are there. The difference between thymine, uracil, the first one is uracil, second one is a thymine, third one is a cytosine. You see the difference between thymine and uracil is, this is a uracil, here you see double bond O, here also double bond O, position 2 and 4, but here also exactly same. But only thing is, at fifth carbon atom contain one methyl group. So this structure, you can call it as 5-methyl uracil. So uracil, and additionally fifth carbon contain methyl. This 5-methyl uracil, we are calling as thymine. This is a cytosine. Cytosine difference, you can see. So in all, they are having at carbon 2 and 4, they have oxygen. But the difference between uracil and thymine and cytosine is, here the fourth carbon contain amino group. But all pyrimidine bases, they have or they contain two nitrogen atom in rings. Position number 1 and 3. Okay, see here position number 1, one nitrogen is there. Position number 3 also, one nitrogen is there. Here also you can see position 1 and 3. So, position 1 and 3. Okay. So, generally, pyrimidine bases, na, they are having two ring structure. One 5-member ring, one 6-member ring. And four nitrogen atom in its rings. Or in its structure within ring. Pyrimidine bases now only single heterocyclic compound, single membrane structure is there, single ring structure. Only 6-member ring, but contain two nitrogen in its rings at position number 1 and 3. Okay? Are you clear with the exact difference between purine and pyrimidine? This is a nitrogen base, right? So next we will see the three parts of nucleotide, nucleotide structure. Okay, see. Here, the structure they are given. So, there are three parts are there. So, each nucleotide has three components. One nitrogen base, one pentose sugar, one phosphate group, right? Like this. This structure, you can call it as nucleotide. Here, nitrogen base, they are given example adenine given. The nitrogen base may be adenine or maybe guanine. Or maybe cytosine, or maybe so thymine. This is because sugar here, the sugar is a deoxyribose. This is a deoxynucleotide. So here OH means that nucleotide is a ribonucleotide, right? Ribonucleotide. So you see here adenine, the first nitrogen atom of adenine, ninth nitrogen atom of adenine is joined with first carbon of sugar. This is a first carbon. This bond name is called N-acetylglycosidic bond. Similarly, the phosphate group is joined with fifth carbon of the sugar. Fifth carbon, joined like this. So this bond name is phosphoester bond, not diester bond, right? Phosphoester bond. So if the compound contain only these two part, nitrogen base and sugar, so nitrogen base sugar alone, you can say it's a nucleoside. Nucleoside along with the phosphate, you can say nucleotide. Okay, so be clear that. So how many types of bonds are found in nucleotide? Na? Only two types of bond. This is a very, very important one. The types of bonds found in nucleotide is two bonds. One is in between nitrogen base and pentose sugar. Either it may be deoxy or ribose sugar. Another bond is between phosphate group and pentose sugar. So the bond which join the nitrogen base with sugar, the bond name is called N-acetyl. Here N-acetyl glycosidic bond. The bond which join the phosphate with sugar name is called phosphoester bond. Don't call it as phosphodiester bond, because phosphodiester bonds are found only in the single stranded DNA or double stranded DNA or single stranded RNA molecule, right? only two types of bonds only found in nucleotide, right? Next we can see the silent feature of double helix structure of DNA. Okay, you see double helix, you see both strands are held together by this yellow color lines, they are given, no? This yellow color lines name is called hydrogen bonding. Hydrogen bonding, right? And this is a double-stranded double helix proposed by James Watson and Francis Crick. You see here, each turn, the size of turn, we told 34 armstrong or 3.4 nanometer. The distance between adjacent base pair is 0.34 nanometer. Okay, 0.34 nanometer, right? Like you see, one strand running, the polarity is 3 frame to 5 prime. Na, another one is run opposite. It's anti-parallel nature. 5 prime to 3 frame. Okay. And width of DNA is a true nanometer. This is a double helix. Okay. So double helix structure. And you see here, the same in a nucleotide form they are given. So one strand running like this. This is a one strand of DNA running like this. Another strand is running in this direction from up to, from bottom to top. This one is top to bottom. So you see 3 prime here they are given, opposite how it is looking, 5 prime. Here 5 prime they are given and opposite is 3 prime. Okay, you see one nucleotide join it with another nucleotide. Okay, see this is a sugar, this is a carbon phosphate. This bond is phosphoester bond. Similarly, this phosphate joined with another sugar here, another sugar. So this bond also phosphoester bond. So in between nucleotide, there are two phosphoester bonds are there in between nucleotide. So here one and here one phosphoester bond and here one phosphoester bond. That's why. So the nucleotide, how they join it and forming polynucleotide, na, the bond which connect the adjacent nucleotide name is called phosphodiester bond. Phosphodiester bond, right? So here in double stranded DNA, this sugar molecule, sugar and phosphate form backbone. Phosphate form backbone. And here nitrogen bases are there. These nitrogen bases are projected innerwards. You see in both strand. You see the outerwards, which one facing? The nucleotide. The ribose sugar and phosphate. In all cases, you can see they are projecting outerwards. Which one projected innerwards? Only the nitrogen bases are projected innerwards, so that the sugar and phosphate mighty of nucleotide will form backbone of either single strand, double stranded structure, double stranded DNA double helix. So nitrogen bases are projected innerwards. Like in nitrogen base, there is a complementary base pairing between two strands of the DNA. So adenine base pair with thymine and guanine base pair with cytosine. Adenine base pair with thymine, how the base pairing, through hydrogen bonding. Hydrogen bonding, how many hydrogen bonds present in adenine thymine? 2. So how many nitrogen bonds are present in guanine and cytosine? 3 hydrogen bonds are present, right? This is a double stranded DNA structure. And in video I given the geometrical information about the DNA double helix. Okay. Next, you see, we discussed the packaging of DNA helix. So actually, interface nucleus, cell nucleus will not contain free DNA. So DNA always associated with some group of proteins. So protein and what kind of structure found in nucleus, interface nucleus, na? The type of material found in this nucleoprotein. The nucleoprotein fiber we are calling as chromatin fiber. But the cell about to divide. So that time what will happen is the cell, the contents further and they form a rod-like structure. The rod-like structure we are calling as chromosome. Okay, that we discussed under packing up DNA helix. You see the knackered DNA is there. It associates with the histone protein. Okay, so totally 9 histone protein I told and 5 types I told. H1, H2A, H2B, H3 and H4. Except H1, remaining are 2 numbers are present. So totally 8 protein together, they form histone octamer. You can see here, the DNA wrapped around this histone octamer for 2 times. Like this, they are wrapped around. But how many coils now? 1/3/4, not 2 complete turn. How much DNA wrapped around this one? Not 200 base pair. This structure we are calling as nucleosome. And again, you see the like lengthy DNA, they uses many histone octamer, they form like this. So this structure we are calling as chromatosomes. So like beads on strings. And again, they undergo coiling, solenoid, solenoid fiber like this. So this chromatin structure 10 nanometer, they again become 30 nanometer. And again, they fold form chromatin. Chromatin, and finally, during metaphase, like you see here, interface like this, interface contain only chromatin fiber. During metaphase, they condense and completely they form one rod-like structure. This rod-like structure we are calling as chromosome. The size of chromosome is 1400 nanometer, right? This is a packing of DNA helix. Okay, we have this diagram, right? And next we discussed about Griffith experiment. The experiment name is called transforming principle or bacterial transformation, right? The what bacteria he used na Streptococcus pneumonia he used, right? You see, what he did is taken live strain. This is a virulent form. It's a capsulated and a smooth strain. So S3 strain. And he injected to mice. Mice dies because of the pneumonia fever. And the live R strain is there. R2. It's a rough strain. It's a non-virulent. And he injected mice. Mice is live because this particular live R strain do not cause any pneumonia fever, any disease. And he can able to heat kill this strain, and he's taken that heat killed compound, injected into mice. Mice is live because there is no infection. And he mixed the living R strain with the dead or heat killed component of S strains, and both he injected into the mice. The mice is died because of pneumonia. And from dead body, he did autopsy. From the dead body, he isolated the live S strain, not live R strain, but he injected only live R strain only. And what conclusion given by Frederick Griffithna? From this experiment, he concluded that some compound of dead S strain transforming live R strain into live S strain. So the transformed S strain, they cause pneumonia. Because of pneumonia, the mice died. Okay, there is a conclusion given by Frederick Griff. And he did not concluded that the transforming agent is DNA. He concluded that some substance, it may be protein or maybe DNA, RNA, it may be carbohydrate, something transforming this live R strain into so live S strain. There is a conclusion given by Frederick Griff, right? So next experiment, the biochemical characterization of transforming principle, that is given by three important scientists: Oswald Avery, Colin McLeod, and McLean McCarty. Right. So what they did? They from heat killed S strain. They are taken heat killed S strain, and they isolated that purified the chemical. Like they are separated lipids, carbohydrate. And they are taken only protein, DNA, RNA alone. They are taken here in three different one, right? So one tube is digested with proteinase. Proteinase, what will happen? They digest all the protein, leave only DNA, RNA here. And here they added ribonuclease. So cleave and remove RNA, leave protein and DNA. And here adding deoxyribonuclease, which cleave DNA alone. And which leave protein and RNA, right? Enzyme treatment. And then injected, these cells are live. So yes, cells appear here because DNA is not disturbed. Here also DNA is not disturbed. But here DNA disturbed so that the no live cells are appear. So that they're injected to mice. In these two cases, mice is die, but here mice is not died because DNA is not there. So from this experiment, they concluded that in a Griffith experiment, the transforming agent, so which substance responsible for transformation of live R strain into live S strain, that is DNA molecule. This is one of the evidence. So evidence that is a DNA as a genetic material, right? Next, another, the unequal experimental proof, that the experimental proof, that that DNA act as a genetic material. So given by Horsey Chase experiment, Alfred Horsey and Martha Chase, they conducted experiment using T2 bacteriophage and E. coli bacteria. Okay, see, first they're taken two set of T2 bacteriophage. So one set, they are grown using S35, sulfur 35 radioactive isotopes. So here the protein coat alone, you can see the except DNA, remaining are labeled with S35. But this set, only DNA is labeled with P32, phosphorus 32, radioactive isotope. And these two set allowed to infect the bacteria separately. They are taken separate two set, one set of E. coli, another set. One set is allowed to infect with the bacteriophage which are labeled with S35. Another one is allowed to infect with bacteriophage which are labeled with P32, right? So it's injecting, it's infecting, and inject its only DNA into the bacteria, okay? But the protein coat is not entering into the bacterial cell. Protein coat staying outside the cell only. After infection, we are giving vigorous agitation so that we are disturbing the contact between virus and bacterial cell. You can see it's attached by agitation, blending process. We are separating the contact between the bacteria and the virus here. So we are separated. This contact is all separated. Then we are going for centrifugation. We are getting one filtrate and a bacterial cell fraction. And this filtrate bacterial cell fraction subjected for autoradiography because we want to see which fraction emitting radiation. And in this experiment, so no sulfur radioactivity is detected in bacterial cell, but the detected sulfur detected only in saponin because the saponin part only contain virus particle. But here the bacterial cells are its source, and the bacterial cells, the radiation is detected, but no radioactivity detected in so the supernatant. So this is one of the experiment that prove that DNA is a genetic material, right? They prove DNA is a genetic material, right? An experiment is so conducted by the scientist name who has conducted, because this is experimental proof for so DNA as a semi-conservative one. Okay, so this experiment is conducted by Michelson and Stahl. So the experiment name is called Michelson and Stahl experiment. Also, it is an experimental proof for DNA replication is semi-conservative one. Okay. Actually, semi-conservative mode of DNA replication is given by, proposed by James Watson and Francis Crick. What they are doing now, initially they are growing this bacteria in N15 media for several generations. And then the isolated DNA from this particular cell, the DNA is isolated DNA separated and purified using cesium chloride density gradient. So in this tube, they got only one band at the bottom of the tube, right? Then their cells are transformed to N14 media and they are allowed to complete the generation 1. After 20 minutes, we are extracting DNA from there. So they got only one band here. So middle, here you see here bottom, here they got middle. Again, the cells allowed to complete second generation only in N14. From there isolated, they got two bands. Oh, okay, you see in this DNA, so both strands are incorporated with N15. So when we are transferring to N14, only one strand is N15, another one will get N14. Hybrid DNA will get. Again, same allowed to complete second generation N14. So that we'll get like this, two hybrid, two lightweight DNA, right? So this is an experimental proof for, so DNA replication is semi-conservative one. Are you clear with this? Right. So up to this, I will end up with this video, and the remaining topic we will continue in next video. Thank you.